Good morning, and welcome to the second of three panels on human sexuality, hosted by the Connectional Table's Human Sexuality Task Force. The first was held in April 2013, and the final one will be held in Mozambique with the voices of the Central Conference members. This task force emerged out of the November 2013 meeting of the Connectional Table and was tasked with being a forum of information for the denomination. With that, I want to turn to Bishop Bruce O, the chair of the Connectional Table, to bring us a word of greeting and prayer.
Grace and peace to you from God our Creator and the Lord Jesus Christ. I too want to welcome you and thank you for your participation in this webcast on human sexuality. You know, the scriptures tell us that our diversity and our unity are gifts from God. In fact, we don't create unity. We are called to maintain it. And that's exactly what this panel is about today, and this discussion is how do we move forward? How do we find a way forward to maintain the unity and the diversity of the church? I'm thankful for these colleagues who have gathered and are offering their perspectives on the way forward. And I would ask you to join me in praying for them and all of us. Let us pray together. Gracious and holy God, we come before you acknowledging that you created us and that we belong to you. We thank you that through the wonder of technology, we can be bound together this day in a conversation, in a dialogue on human sexuality. We come to you acknowledging our brokenness and our fragmented nature. And we pray that your gift of healing will be upon the United Methodist Church. We pray especially this day and in this hour that your Spirit will come and bless all who are participating in this conversation. Be with our panelists, guide their reflections, and be with all of us as we seek to reflect all that you intend us to be, that we might bear witness to your kingdom reign, and that we might contribute in some small way to the building up of all of your people. We pray all of this in the holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop O. Today's panel provides an opportunity for our Episcopal leadership to explore our unique heritage and way of being in connection through the Book of Discipline. The Book of Discipline is, in part, a living work that evolves in time and context as United Methodists discern how to be in mission and ministry together. The Human Sexuality Task Force believes that part of its disciplinary mandate is to enable the flow of information and communication among annual conferences, jurisdictions, central conferences, general agencies, and the Council of Bishops on the issue of human sexuality. Our denomination through the Book of Discipline upholds human sexuality as God's good gift. As United Methodists, we believe that people are only fully human when they acknowledge and express their sexuality. And yet, we struggle with what it means to acknowledge and express our sexuality as we live our life and ministry together. We come before you acknowledging the challenges that have been a part of our denomination around the topic of human sexuality. We recognize the challenges and the pain experienced by many of our brothers and sisters in Christ across the connection because there is disagreement on the church's social principles related to homosexuality. We are not of one mind. Our goal today is to build upon those conversations that have been a part of our history and to discern how to best live our missional lives together with integrity in the midst of changing realities in today's world. These bring our differences to light. In John Wesley's sermon advocating a Catholic spirit, he urged that Christians realize their union in affection and common ground of love in Christ. He pleaded, "May we not be of one heart, though we are not of one opinion?" He went on saying, "Is your heart right with God? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Is your heart right with your neighbor? Do you show your love by your works? If so, give me your hand. Our unity in Christ Jesus calls us to be one. Unity calls together various parts that lead to a more complete and better functioning whole for the sake of the mission. The Connectional Tables Human Sexuality Task Force seeks to uphold our belief that unity is not the same as unanimity or uniformity. Through these live stream conversations, we hope that the people who claim a Christian faith through the United Methodist Church will take the time to listen deeply to one another, to be opened to learn from one another, and to seek a way to live together with integrity for the sake of God's kingdom here and now, and the vision yet to come. We are connected through a book of discipline that was and is created and sustained by people called United Methodists who have prayerfully discerned our doctrine, our theology, and the ecclesiology that binds us together for this time and place. As the body of Christ is a living, moving being, so our discipline continues to live, move, and be an organic creation led by the wisdom of United Methodists who conference together to discern God's call upon us all. How will we live together with integrity as we seek to prayerfully discern where God is leading us as a connection of disciples united by a common mission? How will we live together with integrity when we come from different social, cultural, economic, political, theological mission fields throughout the world? Where is God calling us, the people of the United Methodist Church, to go spread the love of Jesus Christ so that others may come to know our redeeming, our loving, our gracious God? The bishops of our church are willing to lead us in these conversations by engaging with you through this live stream event. Today, we're going to turn our attention to a recent book published through our United Methodist Publishing House. The book, entitled Finding Our Way, Love and Law in the United Methodist Church, is our entry point into this conversation. To help us better understand the purpose and the methodology behind the book, I'd like to turn now to our editor and publisher, Neil Alexander.
Good morning. Good morning to all of us on the panel, and good morning to all who are participating. As Bishop Reuben Jobe and I conceived the book that became Finding Our Way, Love and Law in the United Methodist Church, we had very simple hopes. We believe that the idea of your side versus my side and the labels of Orthodox or progressive are not helping us talk with each other as Christians can and should. And we want to move beyond that. We believe that even the most contested and difficult issues can and should be approachable, and that we can choose to engage each other as sisters and brothers with civility and mutual regard while not shying away from dealing forthrightly with substantial disagreements. In short, we believe that our common calling as disciples places on our lives both a requirement and a capacity to deal with hard things without developing hard hearts or using harsh words. We hunger for our church to wrestle with challenging questions and decisions in a spirit of humble commitment to passionately follow Jesus. As we treated each other with generosity and gracefulness and mutual respect, we're not afraid of turbulence or even schism. We cannot know what the outcome is of our ongoing controversies and debates. But whatever develops in our life together, God will still be God, showering us with grace upon grace. Whatever happens down the line, we want to work for respectful, rigorous, genuine, and prayerful dialogue that may lead in time to an authentic consensus that affirms Jesus Christ is Lord of all. And so we asked bishops, bishops who have different experiences, different perspectives, and have come to sometimes contrary conclusions to share their thoughts with the church. The bishops who took part were generous and forthcoming, and we're grateful for your participation, and we're all indebted to you. We asked bishops to write because they are set apart for servant leadership, including, as the discipline says, an inquiring mind and a commitment to teaching. But we do not see bishops as the only voices or the only speakers on the issue, or as a culmination of the work of discernment and energetic inquiry that needs to take place across the whole of the life of the church. But rather, this is one more contribution in a continuing search for clear vision and faithful living. As they worked, we encouraged the writers to focus on their assigned themes and to make their points clear and emphatic, sometimes drawing sharper lines than they might in daily life. Because we wanted to avoid crossing and blurring the lines between the content of the different contributors in order to present as emphatic and as clear-headed a set of positions as we could. But we encourage all the readers of the book and all of those who may hear today's conversation to look for and discover the points of intersection where ideas will mix and blend and perhaps reveal new ways to frame our shared understandings. Most of all, we pray that by emphasizing the ties that connect as well as facing with openness the issues and words that divide us, we will remember our common baptism. That's the central covenant that defines us as the people called United Methodists. And it is a blessing that breathes into us and the whole world hope and grace and gives us courage and shines a light for finding our way.
Thank you, Neil. Now I'd like to turn to our Episcopal leaders. Bishop Gregory Palmer from the West Ohio Annual Conference, would you like to say a few words about your chapter on Enforce?
Thank you, Amy. I'm delighted to and appreciative to all these colleagues, and especially to Bishop Job and Brother Neil Alexander for the vision that has become Finding Our Way. In the chapter that I was privileged to offer and contribute, I began that chapter by expressing some angst about the term enforce, and also some angst about our ongoing conversation about human sexual practice across four decades in the life of the United Methodist Church. And in place of enforce, I suggested that I preferred a term which I found to be more liturgical for me, the term uphold. And it's found across time in a number of liturgies of the United Methodist Church, where in the making of commitments, persons express their commitment to a particular task, a particular office, and they promise to uphold that which they are charged with. Or sometimes a congregation gathered around a particular service is asked, will you uphold this person or these persons in their ministry? So it seemed to me a more useful and user-friendly term. The second reason that I agreed to participate and what I tried to communicate was that we all have the privilege of coming to these commitments in the Church of Jesus Christ and in the United Methodist Church willingly. We are not especially coerced. We may feel a sense of urgency that brings us to making particular commitments. But what we do in the life of the church, ultimately, we have to say, yes, this is where I want to cast my lot. This is how I want to live out the gospel. These are the people with whom I want to live out my life in Jesus Christ and engage the important mission that God in Christ has called each of us and all of us to. And in order to order the life of the church, we agree to certain covenants, a template, if you will, that sets some boundaries and maps out a path for how we can live our life together. I want to suggest to you that I believe that that's what the Book of Discipline attempts to do, however imperfectly. And inherent in the Book of Discipline, because we get to go to General Conference every 4 years, the Book of Discipline claims no perfection for itself, nor does it cast a light of perfection upon the people who engage that book as a way of living their covenantal life together. But it always reminds us that we are a people who are on the way to perfection. But in the meantime, we've got to have a framework to live out our life as the church, and particularly in the ways in which we have institutionalized the church. The third thing I attempted to communicate was this, that in addition to the Book of Discipline laying out processes for how our covenantal life might be altered and adjusted across time, that the Book of Discipline also had built into it means to deal with our disagreements and our breaches in the life of the church. And so I talked a bit about the complaint process and tried to, number one, debunk the notion that every complaint necessarily ends up in a trial. In fact, all of the data and the evidence is quite to the contrary. But more importantly than that, the complaint process can set a framework that opens a door to deeper conversations about our life together. That's been my experience, and it doesn't mean that the complaint process is the only means to do that, but it does mean that there is some wisdom built into our Book of Polity about how we manage our breaches and our breaches and our disagreements and dissents with one another.
Thank you very much, Bishop Palmer, for those insightful words. Next, we have Bishop Hope Morgan Ward of the North Carolina Annual Conference.
Writing the chapter, Amend, was an opportunity for me to reflect upon a remarkable, challenging, and sustained journey in the North Carolina Annual Conference. In 1998, through a motion of one of the clergy members of the Annual Conference and the leadership of our bishop, we embarked on a process of dialogue which has been sustained now for 16 years. The dialogue has intentionally, at every point from the very first meeting, gathered people of diverse perspective, including LGBTQ persons and their families. Faithful leaders continue to stay at this table, speaking honestly from the heart out of deep and faithful Christian conviction. There is little counting of changed minds, but there is a better and richer fruit among us. The rancor which we experienced at earlier times is lessened. Friendships continue across diverse and wide opinion, and we have increased our ability to engage in all sorts of difficult conversations. The word amend, I confess, was new to me. It is used in the parlance of editing and publishing, and it helps reflect upon what's happening in our life together. The more familiar word, amend, with an A, describes the adding of something not previously present. To amend is to revise from within. And through the circling of chairs, the convening of conversation, we have experienced a richer and fuller and more faithful life as an annual conference. We are still certainly on a journey. However, we see that our life together is better and more whole and more life-giving and more hospitable and more welcoming as a result of these sustained conversations. And so, my chapter is an urging for convening of dialogue across our beloved church. When we engage with one another, we are embodying and offering love, the mark of the Wesleyan way. When we create safe and hospitable spaces for engagement, we're inviting the work of the Holy Spirit. We're able to find better words than the words we have used. We're able to move forward together. Remarkable things will happen if we're sufficiently bold and humble to create a circle of chairs and to talk with one another.
What a great vision, Bishop Ward. We're going to turn now to retired Bishop Melvin Talbert, who wrote the chapter on Disobey, Our Discipline But Obey the Bible. Bishop Talbert?
Thank you very much. I'm gratified for the privilege that I've had to participate in this discussion and to have a chance to express my views in the chapter own disobey. For me, it's biblical obedience. You will find that in the book. I wrote this chapter to express the view that the derogatory language in paragraph 161F of the Book of Discipline regarding homosexuals and the prohibitive law, paragraph 341.6 in the Book of Discipline requiring clergy and congregations to discriminate against persons who are practicing homosexuals, I declare that those paragraphs are wrong and no longer deserve our loyalty and support. I take this stand as one who has been part of this struggle in our church for more than 40 years. I was in the General Conference in 1972 as a delegate when this derogatory language was put in. As a bishop in the church for 20 years, I struggled with the language and was clear with the persons that I had oversight for, indicating that that position is wrong. And so as a retired bishop for 14 years, my mind has not changed. Prior to the 2012 General Conference, I made every effort possible to stay in solidarity with members of my Council of Bishops on this issue of homosexuality. But the actions of the 2012 General Conference forced me to choose between the official stance of our church and the call of God upon my life as a Christian, as a pastor, and as a bishop. Needless to say, this was not an easy thing to do. I love and respect my colleagues in the Council of Bishops. I love my church. It is because of my church and the Council of Bishops that I am the person that I am today. As a poor country boy from a small town of Clinton, Louisiana, it is my church that has made it possible for me to have had so many opportunities and privileges to represent the church in various settings around the world. Yet there comes a time when one must be true to the claim of God on one's life, even if that means taking a stand against one's church. So at the 2012 General Conference, I prepared and released a statement declaring that the derogatory language in our social principles and the unjust laws in our Book of Discipline no longer deserve our loyalty and support. Further, I framed and called for an act of biblical obedience, which is a conscious act of disregarding derogatory language about homosexual persons and calling on clergy and laity to disobey the unjust laws requiring pastors and congregations to discriminate against homosexuals. Mine is a call to do the right thing, no matter what. Simply stated, I chose to use my authority as a bishop to speak a prophetic word of hope and challenge to my church and to stand in solidarity with my LGBTQ sisters and brothers who are continually marginalized by our church. And I stand in solidarity with clergy and laity who signed an altar for all and are choosing to perform same-gender weddings despite the actions of General Conference. I've done a same-gender wedding because I was asked to do so, and it was the right thing to do. I believe the way forward is to choose to live with our differences and embrace each other with respect. Whether we like it or not, we are all part of the family of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop Talbert. Part two is our responses, or let me stop there and turn to Bishop Carter, who is from the Florida Annual Conference, and his chapter is on disarm.
Thank you. It's an honor to be a part of this conversation today. One of the complexities of this conversation that we're having is that we likely do not agree about the issue that's most in need of definition. For some, it would be scriptural fidelity. For others, inclusiveness. And for yet others, it is about the renewal of the local church. Since there are passionate advocates in each of these tribes, I want to suggest that there's an issue that's foundational to each of these three concerns. That is the unity, mission, and integrity of the church. The scriptures are interpreted faithfully within the church. For inclusiveness to have practical and real meaning, there must be an actual community with the capacity to receive new persons. And if there is to be a future with hope, we cannot simply maintain the status quo, which is unsustainable. I note this concern because at present we lack a desire, I believe, for unity, an intentionality for mission, and a commitment to integrity. And the symptoms of our current reality can be found in the harm persons are doing to each other, in local churches, in print, in social media, in ecclesial gatherings, in the larger culture. In addition, I confess that this matter is complex and mysterious, and the rate of cultural change differs across our global church. There's also the relation of church to culture. Should the church mirror the culture or be in conversation or conflict with it? We struggle with these questions. I would suggest that the symptom of our lack of unity and integrity as a denomination comes from a deeper condition, and that is our theological incoherence. On one side of the issue, there is a theology of prevenient grace and social holiness. And on the other side, there is a theology of justifying grace and personal piety. I've often had the sense that our communication does not move us more deeply toward any kind of solution to the present impasse because we're actually talking past each other. I affirm the opportunity for us to speak with each other, remembering the teaching of the letter of James 1, to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. I believe that God's grace can be the foundation of our thinking about human sexuality. And I also believe that God's grace can shape the way we speak with each other about this subject in our church in the present moment. In the chapter that I wrote entitled Disarm, I was really making the case for our not doing harm and violence to each other as we proceed along this journey. In a few weeks, we'll be in the season of Advent, and I simply lift up a verse of scripture that will be read in many congregations who will light the Advent candle of peace, from Luke 1, 78-79. Because of God's deep compassion, the dawn from heaven will break down upon us to give light to those who are sitting in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide us on the path of peace.
Thank you, Bishop Carter. Part two is our responses, and it begins with Bishop Mike Lowry's response with a chapter on order. Bishop Lowry?
Seeking to find our way forward in the current crisis engulfing United Methodism, any of the options suggested virtually beg for a deeper consideration of the meaning and the importance of order in the life of the church. Order contains within its essence a doctrinal character, what we teach, and a disciplinary character, how we shall act together. It is not to be regarded lightly or set aside casually. Our current rage against order and struggle about order is a contentious argument about proper boundaries and indeed about the very nature of whether such boundaries properly exist. The debate in the United States branch of the United Methodist Church worldwide is exacerbated by the rampant individualism of our culture, which infects our very understanding of what it means to be in covenant community. We pay a high cost for disorder when we emasculate or deny what it means to follow church order as covenantally established and legally upheld. Faithful civil disobedience understands the need for order through accountability. Lack of accountability corrupts an understanding of covenant and offends the very integrity of the advocated biblical obedience. The high cost of disorder further infects the church as a whole. Covenant promises are compromised. Injustice becomes the charge by multiple parties, which leads to a culture of victimization. The question is legitimately raised: if the discipline doesn't apply to others, why should I have to follow it? Missional resources are diverted or depleted. Friends, the ultimate cost of disorder may be the United Methodist Church itself. Furthermore, such disorder belies an unintended colonialism, a potential, I emphasize the word potential, majority of the church in the United States tends to want to tell a majority of representatives outside the United States that their vote does not really count or matter on same-gender issues. The refusal to abide by a majority vote is itself injurious to community. We need to reorder our connection based on covenantal community with genuine humility and with a deep trusting of the Holy Spirit's guidance. I thank you, and I celebrate this opportunity to share together in Christ.
Thank you very much, Bishop Lowry. I do want to acknowledge that Bishop John K. Yambasu wrote the chapter on unity. Unfortunately, Bishop Yambasu could not be with us today. He serves the Sierra Leone Annual Conference and could not come due to the quarantine policies recently implemented by the United States government related to the Ebola virus. So last, we're going to turn to Bishop Rosemary Venner of the Germany Central Conference so she can bring us one perspective from our brothers and sisters in Europe.
Thank you and greetings to all of you. It's an honor, as my colleague said, to be part of this group and to contribute to the work here. When I was asked to write a chapter in the book, I was the president of the Council of Bishops at that time, and I was asked to write comments on these perspectives. In my chapter, I refer to a term that is common in the European ecumenical movement, the term unity in reconciled diversity. I think this term expresses very well how we have to learn to live together in our church. Diversity and unity are both God's gift to the world and to the church. We United Methodists aim to become more diverse. This is one of our goals in the attempt to make disciples of Jesus Christ, to invite more people, more diverse people, more younger people. And we need to find adequate expressions for the unity in Christ that bounds us together. It is not enough to be bound together by church law, and it's my opinion that the Book of Discipline is not mainly a book of law. It's a book that describes our covenant and life. It describes how we understand ourselves as United Methodists in the Wesleyan family. In order to express Christian unity in reconciled diversity, we have mainly to develop missional opportunities together. I think the unity is for the sake of the mission, as we have heard earlier in this panel. So missional opportunities will help us to engage with one another, although we disagree in many perspectives, and to challenge one another to grow in love and to grow in good works. As a Council of Bishops, we ourselves have to model what a unity and reconciled diversity might look like. We are like the whole church. We are not of one mind on many questions, including the question how to look at human sexuality. And we are called to lead collectively, and we have to find expressions how to do this in a covenantal life together. In this current time, I see two main challenges for us as a denomination. One challenge is how can we faithfully express what we believe? We believe God's grace is for all. We believe all are welcome in our church. How can we find ways to express in a more faithful and less harmful way that this is our common belief? And the second challenge, how can we love one another and engage with one another in holy conversations as we disagree on what biblical obedience means with regard to human sexuality and perhaps to several other questions as well? Why is it important to stay together as United Methodists? Our fragmented world needs our church as a sign of hope and as a sign of unity. We have the unique gift of being a worldwide church, living together in many continents, in many different contexts, and being in mission together in many different contexts. We currently have to learn and we engage in conversations what it means to be a worldwide church. We will certainly have to allow ourselves more flexibility in order to be missionally relevant in the various contexts. And at the same hand side, all of us are called to come together to find unity in Christ as we come to the communion table. This is our center, as it is our call to mission. At the communion table, we together are praying, by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. I trust that God answers this plea. Thank you for listening and engaging with us.
Thank you so much, Bishop Venner, for those words and those thoughts. And thank you to all of our panelists. I'm going to turn one last time to Neil Alexander to bring the voice of Bishop Reuben Job, who wrote the last part of the book, Trust God to Discern a Way Forward. Neil?
Thank you, Amy. Let me say as clearly as I can that Reuben's contribution is like that of all of the other bishops. These are letters to the church. They each stand independently, but they seek to come together in some coherence and some clues about the future. But here's Reuben's letter to the church. He's known to many of us for his teaching and guidance and awakening spiritual comprehension and in shaping and sharing practices to take us deeper into active engagement with God's leading and sanctifying love. He's co-author of A Guide to Prayer, has written numerous books, including Three Simple Rules, A Wesleyan Way of Living. Bishop Job is 86 years old, and he's now graced by the love of his family, friends, and the attentive care of his visiting hospice nurse, and he awakes every day and welcomes each minute with gratitude to God. Reuben told Bishop Palmer and I just this last week, he is ready for life and for death. He is ready for life after death, with equal measures of curiosity, thanksgiving, and praise. He couldn't be here today, but I suspect he's online, and I know he's praying for all of us and for all of the church. Reuben writes in his chapter, Finding Our Way, that we yearn for peace and joy that transforms our lives, for a relationship with Christ that is intimate and powerful, and ever mindful of God's presence, companionship, and comfort. He affirms that we yearn for congregations and a denomination where love for God and neighbor are so real, so vibrant, so active, that every issue, even these issues, can be faced openly, prayerfully, honestly, and respectfully. A would-be critic told me, "Oh, Reuben just wants us all to be nice." But the observation couldn't be more mistaken. Reuben's prayer isn't for peace, peace where there is no peace. It is for a profoundly authentic, faithfulness that is worthy of the name of the one we follow, an attitude of heart, mind, and practice befitting those who Jesus Christ calls his friends. Reuben Job writes with dismay over the tone and content of the arguments on all sides of the issue of same-gender relationships. Across the spectrum that seem to reflect commitments to law over grace or notions of truth over love, and are therefore all incompatible with Christian teaching. Reuben reminds us that the church has never been or will not likely be perfect, but it can be transformed and transforming. And he asks us to start with ourselves. Start now, he pleads. With God's help, I can surrender my life to the transforming, life-giving power of the Holy Spirit, and in that very moment, begin a journey towards wholeness and faithfulness. Bishop Job asserts that placing our trust in God and seeking God's direction is not a call to just pray about it, but rather an invitation to radical, risky, and complete trust in God instead of trust in our own ingenuity and rhetoric. He points out that it will not be easy because we have fatigue and hurt of 42 years of combat over same-gender relationship issues that leave us severely wounded, divided, polarized, and drained. But knowing that his request will at first surprise and possibly offend some, Reuben asks us to let it all go, to loosen the grips of the lesser gods that hold us captive, and place our full and complete trust in God. The resulting proposals may seem profoundly bold to some or even naive to others. Reuben asks us to do three things. One, immediately stop all propaganda. Step back from spouting words of law as if we speak for Moses and turn to the words instead and the commands of Jesus. One friend told me, "I resent Reuben's implication. Our side isn't sending out propaganda, we're doing education." Yet Reuben appeals to it for a dramatic change in tone by all of us so that we can engage in discourse that truly becomes holy conversation. Second, declare a moratorium on celebrations and trials regarding same-gender unions. This idea of intentionally pulling back from the faith in action that many on differing so-called sides of the argument see as obedience, courage, and a genuine witness to truth will be especially hard. It can feel like a call to passivity, even capitulation or disengagement. But Reuben sees it instead as a critical prelude to a deeper and more risky and faith-based reliance on the presence and power and guidance of the living God who sustains us. He tells us that by creating a space, it makes it more possible to live into his third recommendation, and it is this: begin a practice of prayer and discernment that leaves our preferences outside as we enter a period of seeking only God's direction and not our own. This is the essence of Reuben's outrageous proposal. It is that the denomination and as we as disciples of Jesus Christ give first priority to prayer. For prayer to be a priority and not a sometime additive and tangential activity, we must be willing to give up the deceptive idea that we are strong and wise enough to control our lives without divine intervention. Bishop Job's confident expectation for the people called United Methodists is this: the more we place ourselves in God's presence, the more we will sense that holy presence, and the more we will become like that holy presence, and the more we become like that holy presence, the more we will find ourselves fulfilling the request of the Jesus we follow, the Jesus who teaches what is required. And it is this: to love God with our whole being and to love our neighbors as ourselves. The transformation in our lives moves to transformation of our relationships. Then what seemed like it was impossible becomes achievable. Indeed, all things are possible with God. And Reuben prays for us today fervently and simply, trust God.
Amen. Amen. Trust God. In early October, we released a press statement that it asked individuals to compose a YouTube video in which they would tell their story and pose a question to the panelists and the authors. We only had 4 submissions to the request, and they represent 1 distinct perspective of our church. For the next few minutes, we're gonna present these YouTube videos to the panel and invite you all as panelists to respond to the videos. The first video comes from Jeff.
Good morning, and thank you for this opportunity. My name is Jeff Holland Lupton, and I am a member of United Methodist Church in Raleigh, North Carolina. My husband, Joe Lupton, was the director of music at our church for 17 years. We met in 1998 and enjoyed a loving, committed, monogamous relationship. In 2010, Joe was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. In the summer of 2011, we traveled to Glastonbury, Connecticut, and were married at First Church of Christ there. One of our biggest dreams was to be able to be married at our church in Raleigh, which we loved, by our pastor, one of our favorite people, and close friend. Given the same-sex marriage law in North Carolina, we knew it would not be legal. However, given the fact that we were being legally married in Connecticut, we toyed with the idea of at least having a ceremony in Raleigh where our friends and family could attend and have our pastor officiate. But because of the respect and admiration we have for him, we never asked because we did not want to put him in the position to have to say no, or worse yet, say yes and face terrible consequences by the United Methodist Church. Joe was one of the most gifted and talented musicians and teacher of music that a church could possibly hope for. Joe died in January of 2013. The outpouring of love and support for me and the mourning of the loss of Joe is something that affected so many people and our church to its very core. We had to open the fellowship hall for the overflow crowd of 400 for his memorial service, and to accommodate the mass choir of 100 that sang so beautifully. Since Joe's death, I have continued to attend our church, have become more involved in many aspects of leadership. I have faithfully supported the church with my time, my talents, and my tithe. However, every Sunday I have an inner battle with my conscience, wondering if I am doing the right thing. I am a member in good standing with a denomination that does not place any value on the marriage that I hold so dear. I am a member in good standing of a church that implicitly states that being a gay person is incompatible with Christian teaching. Am I betraying myself by continuing to support the United Methodist Church? It would be simpler to just walk away, go to the nearest Church of Christ or the nearest Episcopal Church, but I love my local congregation. In my opinion, I contribute to the betterment of my church. But the United Methodist Church does not value me. Why should I stay?
Thank you, Jeff. I'm going to turn to our panelists. Bishop Ward, are you ready to respond?
Yes. Jeff, I want to thank you for the witness that you have given to us. And I also want to thank God for the witness of Joe and for the witness of this local congregation of the United Methodist Church in North Carolina. This witness helps us to appreciate the possibilities within congregational life for authentic interaction, for truthfulness, for loving relationships, for the flowing of gifts. And I want to thank you because within the North Carolina Annual Conference, through the process of dialogue over the last 16 years, at the 2013 Annual Conference, a resolution was passed that the discipline should be more open to all people. And in 2014, a unity resolution was passed that we continue to live in unity across our differences. These kinds of movements have only been possible because of the faithfulness of persons like yourself and the congregation of which you are a part. Your question's a very probing one, and I haven't answered it directly. I don't know what I would do if I were you, but as the bishop who shares life with you in the North Carolina Annual Conference, I thank you for your witness. I thank your local church for their remarkable life, and I express hope for all our life together.
Thank you. Thank you, Bishop Ward. We're going to try to show all four videos. So in an effort to do that, we're going to go ahead and go on to the second video and then allow one of our other colleagues to respond.
Hello, my name is Julie Wood. My husband and I were born into the United Methodist Church. My dad was even a minister. We had a beautiful little boy named Ben. He received commitments from us, his church, and the congregation when he was baptized to be nurtured in a community of faith. He grew up with friends that he made all the way back to nursery. Just as we had, he was consistently very active in the church. He was confirmed. He helped bring his sisters here, one from China and another born a few months later. He took this role very seriously. He transitioned into the church youth group. He went on every retreat and mission trip. It was cherished. He was the district representative Daniel Conference at Lake Junaluska for several years and for the western part of the state. Unfortunately, the impact of the United Methodist Church has not all been positive. A new leader arrived. Soon, Ben was worked out of all his leadership roles. The leader told Ben that because he was gay, he was going to hell. He was not worthy of being a part of the group and no representation of Christ. The leader pressured the other children to state they were uncomfortable being around him. During the confrontation that followed, he screamed at my husband and I that being gay is an abomination. I'm almost certain that these are the shoes and the shirt that he was wearing. I'm almost certain it's when his spirit was broken. There was no golden rule, no singing Jesus loves the little children, and there was certainly no Good Samaritan. Our grounding was gone. On May 8, 2013, Ben died by suicide. We'll never know how much of an impact this traumatizing time at youth had on his decision to end his pain, but I know he never stepped foot back into a church. Questions. What is our chief purpose as a church? Is it to bring people into a loving relationship with Christ or to create barriers that push people away from Christ? Please consider that the words in a book of discipline and treatment as second-class citizens does not say to one that they are worthy. These actions breed abuse. What can we do to change this? People are in the same seat that Ben was in at this very moment. Spiritual trauma is real. Please have courage. Look at the bumper stickers that were on Ben's car. One says, "What if the hokey pokey is what it's all about?" United Methodist Church, I have given you so much of my life, and I entrusted my most beloved to your care. We need your leadership and courage to simply show love. Thank you.
Bishop Carter, you ready to respond?
I would. First, I just want to say that the suicide of any person is a profound tragedy. In the gift of a life that is lost to us and in the chaos and the confusion that is left behind, and I hear that in Julie's voice. And my initial response is to try to be present to those who are suffering and to hear their cries just as God hears our cries in Exodus 3. In my default way of being present to this person and family as a shepherd and a pastor, I did that work for 28 years. And that is clearly missing in the narrative we've seen. As with Bishop Ward, I often have the sense that congregations can be better at this than our denomination. And as I hear this narrative, I also hear, have the sense that this is not only a failure at the denominational level, but at the local level, where people become disciples and experience grace. I wish there had been a pastor or a youth minister or leader who could have shared with Ben the grace that is in our tradition, the gospel that Jesus loves every one of us and wants to redeem us and make us whole. I have written and said publicly that the incompatibility sentence is not helping us in our mission. And people hear that as if it is spoken with a megaphone, and they do not hear the words in our tradition that are deep words of grace. I wish the youth director or leader or whoever is at the background of this narrative had said that every person is a person of sacred worth, and that we're created in the image of God, and that the ground is level at the foot of the cross. And I believe it had this been where the relationship had begun, there would have been a holy and gracious space for Ben to continue in his journey. And I just acknowledge the as a pastor and a shepherd, which is a part of the role of a bishop, the loss that is here.
Thank you, Bishop Carter. I think Bishop Talbert wants to say a few words.
This video is a classic example of why it's time for us as bishops to lead the church rather than simply leaving it to a decision of General Conference. I think our denomination has to bear blame for some of the things that happen in our name when people across the denomination use the Book of Discipline in a derogative way. And this is a classic example of why I felt it was very important for at least a bishop to make the statement that the Book of Discipline is not God. The Book of Discipline is one that is created by human beings, and human beings are not God. It's time for us to, as a denomination, take responsibility for the actions that our decision calls on the lives of people. And so my heart aches and pain for the thousands of people across the church who are suffering and hurting like this mother of her precious son.
Thank you, Bishop Talbert. We're going to go ahead and go on to the third video.
Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. My name is Douglas Asbury. I'm an ordained elder in the Northern Illinois Conference of the United Methodist Church, a gay man, and a fellow child of God. It is common knowledge that the Bible is concerned with sin, guilt, and redemption. All of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and have no power to rid ourselves of the sin that binds us. But the Spirit of God brings freedom from sin and guilt through drawing us into union with Christ Jesus and making us his disciples. Through this Spirit, we come to know ourselves as children of God and co-heirs to eternal life with Christ, from whose love nothing can separate us. What usually goes unnoticed is the Bible's concern for shame, which is mentioned even prior to its concern about sin and guilt. In the garden, Adam and Eve were naked and yet not ashamed. Why were they not ashamed? I suggest that it is because they were created in the image and likeness of God, as Genesis 1 tells us all humans are. Yet being ignorant of that fact, they believed the serpent's lies that they were not like God, but would become so if they violated God's instruction not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Thus the serpent's lies aroused shame in Adam and Eve in the form of the sense that there was something wrong with them, that they were not like God, according to the lying serpent, but that they could overcome their shame by choosing to violate God's command. The result, however, was not greater godlikeness, as we know, but both guilt and even greater shame demonstrated by the aroused sense of the need to cover themselves and to hide from the one who had given them the very breath of life and the divine image. This shame that leads humans into the sin that brings only guilt and further shame became the pattern throughout the Bible. The Old and New Testaments make reference 68 times to the calumny of being put to shame. To be put to shame is to be counted as worthless. The pattern found in the Bible is a pattern that continues to be alive in the world today, including in our church. The questions we must answer are these. Will the United Methodist Church continue to shame LGBTQ children of God as being something other than persons of sacred worth by continuing to claim that every practice of their God-given sexuality, even that which exhibits the Spirit of Christ in its expression, is inherently less worthy of affirmation than any such sexual practice by God's straight children? Or will it affirm that the practice of human sexuality among all children of God that exhibits the Spirit of Christ is affirmed and supported regardless of their sexuality, while that which brings shame upon the partners, or even upon a brother or sister in Christ, is rejected? I pray God's blessing upon your deliberations.
All right, friends. Bishop Palmer, will you respond?
Thank you. I'd like to say in response to the last two videos, the first is to Julie, I believe, was this, I'm sorry, and the whole church ought to be sorry for anyone that in the name of the church said such heinous and disrespectful and unloving and ungraceful things to your son. Mm-hmm. And for the ways in which that contributed to some sense of him doing harm to himself and the harm that it has done to your family. I'm sorry, and I'm sure that all of my colleagues here and all of those who are bishops in our beloved church would join me in addressing you with that collective, we are sorry for that deep kind of pain and for the ways in which that the leadership in that particular place did not represent the grace of the gospel. To Brother Douglas, who I want to commend him for his very adroit means of illuminating the Genesis text, and there's so much that he offered that I resonated with, and I suspect others do as well. And one response that I have, and it came out in the introduction that you offered, Amy, and in the statement that the Council of Bishops issued last year following its meeting in November, affirming in the largest public way to date in any kind of official statement, the sense that there is not of one mind in the life of the whole church and even in the life of the council. And I think just saying that was a huge step forward, and that we have missed a number of opportunities, particularly when the church has been convened in its legislative process to what I call let a bit of air into the room by naming some truth about that sense of dissent in the life of the church about finding a path forward to be more loving, more just, more grace-filled in relationship to all of our sisters and brothers in the church, and may I say all sisters and brothers in the human family who have yet to respond in faith to the good news of the gospel that we claim and I think are making as many good faith efforts, but need to make more good faith efforts to incarnate so that it is word and it is deed as well.
Thank you, Bishop Palmer. Anyone else? Bishop Lowry, would you give us a word?
I think I would echo what Bishop Palmer has already shared on this issue. And I would add that as those who seek to live out of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that shame is not a tool or a weapon that should ever be applied or used to anyone, that rather our stance must be one that steps forward in a grace that honors God's preferences and seeks to treat all people as loving children of God. And I think that's the essential stance that we move forward with, regardless of where we stand on any particular sense of church law or order in this kind of issue. So I think the first and strongest thing we want to say in the context of the brother from Northern Illinois who brought the witness, basing it on the opening passages of Genesis, is an appreciation for that witness and a word that moves us beyond shame for all individuals, even while we may wish to properly debate our disagreements on the issue.
Thank you, Bishop Lowry. We're gonna take time for the last video.
Reverend Sarah Thompson Tweedy. I serve on a part-time basis at Memorial United Methodist Church in White Plains, New York, and also am the chair of Methodist and New Directions, also known as MIND, an organization committed to the full inclusion of LGBTQ people in the United Methodist Church. In the very recent past, a complaint was filed against me for being, in the words of the Book of Discipline, a self-avowed practicing homosexual, because I am married to a woman. I want to challenge the Connectional table to include more queer voices. We are consistently left out of the conversation. Progressives love to talk for us. Conservatives love to talk against us. We have been called the issue, and we have been called the problem, but we never seem to be called to the table. How can there be real dialogue if the church won't talk with us? If you want to have dialogue, then talk to us, LGBTQ United Methodists, about how our church's stance contributes to our ostracism, oppression, and marginalization, reducing us to second-class members of our own church. Talk to a teen who has experienced religious bigotry from their parents who turned them out onto the streets. Talk to trans women of color who've been brutally attacked. Talk to families of kids who took their own lives because they were told that God doesn't love them. Talk to same-sex couples denied the opportunity to be married in their churches and by their pastors, churches they have worked as hard as anybody to build. Talk to a candidate for ministry caught in the quandary of accepting God's call but being told to sacrifice her personal integrity by staying in the closet. For us LGBTQ Methodists, more conversation about how to be a church that continues to discriminate is nothing more than that. Just talk. We cannot wait for permission from the Book of Discipline to be who God created us to be. We cannot turn away from same-sex couples looking to be married in their churches. General Conference 2016 is not the mechanism by which we will become an inclusive church. There is only one way forward: refusing to discriminate. Starting now, let us live into the vision of a truly inclusive community and bring LGBTQ people into the full life of the church. For our actions, not our words, reflect our commitment to justice.
Thank you. I'm going to turn to Bishop Venner to give those thoughts from that video.
Thank you. Thank you, Amy, and thank you, Reverend Sarah, for your thoughtful words and your invitation and your plea for conversation, for speaking with one another and not talking about one another. And I really echo what you are saying, and I think even this conversation today, where we talk amongst us bishops, and Neil Alexander as our publisher, is only one step, and the more important step is that we create space, that we create room for grace, room for confession. We had moments of confession just a minute ago, and I'm thankful for the colleagues offering it. And we need a space where we can sit together, where we can listen to our experiences, and where we can seek better ways to live as a church where we have different opinions, although we are together as sisters and brothers of Christ, and we learn how to offer Christ to the world in a more faithful work. So I just echo what you are saying. It's not a mechanism that General Conference will change our church. It's all of us learning to live in a Christ-like way and to love one another and to engage with one another to find our way forward.
Thank you very much, Bishop Venner. Thank you to everybody who sent a YouTube video. One of the only ways we can continue to do this is with your input, your participation, your suggestions and your questions. We really do appreciate you taking the time to tell your story and ask your questions. Next, we're going to turn to the last portion of our conversation this day, in which we're going to invite Twitter watchers and those of you who are watching live stream to ask us some questions, specifically using Twitter or Facebook. You can use the Twitter hashtag CTTalks, and we're going to choose some of these questions as they come in and present them to the panel. You may either ask a question to the entire panel or to a specific bishop. And if you could please limit some of your questions to 2 to 3 sentences and keep them specific to the book, Finding Our Way, or what you've heard from the panel in the last hour. We've got one question here. One is to all of us here at the panel, why is there no LGBTQ voice on the panel? And our response to that from the Connectional table side is that we chose to utilize the book Finding Our Way, and these were the authors of the book at this time. Other voices we hope would be heard through our videos as well as the questions that come at this point. Any other responses? Bishop Ward, you are a member of the Human Sexuality Task Force. Yeah, we can go ahead and turn to this question. One of the questions from Be Warm is, our purpose as United Methodists to maintain unity or to preach the good news and make disciples for Jesus Christ?
The dichotomy which is set up by this question embodies the way in which we are unhelpfully moving forward. I appreciate very much your question because it is an example of over-againstness rather than realizing the interaction of these aspects of our life. Our desire and work toward unity, of receiving God's fullest gift of unity, is not a competition with truth or other words that we might use. Rather, unity is a gift of the Holy Spirit. It is that for which Christ prayed before his death. It is over and over again lifted in the scriptures as a gift of the Holy Spirit. So our desire, our work toward unity in having these sorts of conversations is to create, through the power of the Holy Spirit, a church that is more healthy and more dynamic and more a stronger vessel for God's use, for preaching the good news and for making disciples of Jesus Christ. One of the earliest observations of the Christian community, famously said, was, see how they love one another. To preach good news and to live in tension and in embattlement with one another is a contradiction in terms. The two have to go together.
Thank you very much, Bishop Ward. Bishop Venner?
May I add one sentence? I was recently reading a quote of Desmond Tutu, Bishop Desmond Tutu, saying of the struggle in South Africa against apartheid, the task would have been too big to do it as a divided church. And this was challenging me. I think we can do many things together in our unique church, being a church in many continents, so that we really have to learn how to live out the unity given to us in Christ for the sake of making disciples in a very diverse and very, in many ways, broken world. This is why I engage myself to find a way forward so that we can move on together. The task is too big for more splits and more divisions.
Yeah, go ahead.
Just wanted to comment on the question about unity, and it did seem to privilege making disciples over unity. Bishops are people who have made a particular promise to try to unify the church, and I realize that unity is often a secondary value for many people after what they perceive as truth or what they perceive as justice. In my own devotional life, I've gone back to just a two-sentence statement that is in the Rule of Taze. Many people have been enriched by the music of the Taze community, and this is the statement: never resign yourself to the scandal of the separation of Christians who so readily profess love for their neighbor and yet remain divided. Make the unity of the body of Christ your passionate concern. I just want to inject that wisdom into our conversation that, you know, we really do believe that we are people on a journey toward holiness and sanctification. And for people in the Wesleyan tradition, we cannot be holy or sanctified without loving our neighbor. And we cannot love our neighbor without having a deep desire for unity in the body of Christ.
Go ahead, Bishop Talbert.
As I sit here hearing us use nice words and phrases, I sense a growing anger, because we as bishops never put it on the table like we are attempting to do here this morning within the context of our council. And I hope we can do that. We don't use the power and authority that we have as set-apart bishops in this church. Our authority is not limited by what is in the Book of Discipline. Our authority is responding to the one whom we gave our lives to when we were ordained as clergy, when we were consecrated as bishops. And that was not to the Book of Discipline, but to God. And it's time for us as bishops to do that. It's time for us as bishops to say to our church, the position of our church is wrong. And if we can't do that, I don't know what all of this talk of unity is about. We need to acknowledge our wrong, our sin, and then we can move forward.
I'm going to lift up Greg Neal's question. It is around what we've been talking about here already, and he asks, you know, what is it that unites the church? Our doctrinal standards, conformity to rules and regulations, or, as Bishop Talbert was suggesting, our faith in Jesus Christ? How do you respond to Greg's question? Bishop Venner?
It's again not an either or. Per se that we are called by Christ and that we respond to his call to discipleship. And as long as we move together in one church, we have to find expressions for our church life, and therefore we have to struggle with the questions that Bishop Talbert was laying before us. We are not one-minded on how we interpret the Bible at this point, I think that we still can move on together as long as we are one-minded in God's grace is for all, and let's offer grace to all people, and let's find ways to live together in a less painful and less harmful way by giving us more freedom to express grace to all people. But we have to find a way to order our life as a church. So the unity is given in Christ, and the church life has also needs expressions in order for our life together.
Thank you, Bishop Lowry.
I want to come back to the theme of unity, and I want to challenge a bit where I think we're coming out. We are children, after all, of the Protestant Reformation, which means there was a time in our life as a church in which we chose disunity over unity for the sake of faithfulness. And a part of what we're being pushed on, I think rightly so, this is an oversimplification, rightly so by both sides. Now, I quite realize they're more than just two sides to this. It's really a whole spectrum. But we are rightly being pushed on the question of the way unity relates to mission. And the church, at least in the Reformation, made the statement that mission trumped unity. Now, that's not saying unity is unimportant, but it is saying that unity has to be within the context of mission. It's one thing to say that the initial question that got us on this subject is, in fact, setting up a dichotomy that we do not need to embrace. That's true. But even once we have said that much, we still need to understand that there is at times a choice between unity or mission that we cannot duck, and we must face with some honesty. And I think a part of our words are to challenge that issue. Does the mission of spreading the gospel, of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, mean that at some point we need to look square in the eye of what it might mean to be a very different church? I'm enamored by your phrase, Bishop Venner, of unity in reconciled diversity. Now, that seems to me to at least give us an opportunity to explore what reconciled diversity might look like, because I suspect that would look like something that is not the surrender of either side of this equation, but rather how do we live as a genuinely, deeply divided church in a way that does not shame or disregard either position. And again, I want to acknowledge pretending it's two positions, I know is a shortcut for what is a far more complex issue.
Thank you. Bishop Palmer, do you want to respond to this question? And
sure.
Then we'll go back to our Twitter feed.
I want to remind myself and perhaps others of something that was said earlier. I think Bishop O reminded us at the beginning in his greeting that unity, the unity of the body, the unity of the church, is a gift. So it's a gift to be received. Do we have responsibility to live into that? Do we work at it, so to speak? Of course, but it's not something that we can manipulate or frankly control, but it is a gift to be received, and we have to pay attention to the ways in which we are being attentive to the gift and treating it as a gift. Clearly, we've shown across time, meaning the history of the whole church writ large, that it's a fragile gift in the sense that without great care on our part, it can slip away from us, but God continues to offer that gift back to us. What unifies us, this question of, you know, is it the preaching of the good news of Jesus Christ? Is it the mission? Is it the discipline? I want to underscore what's been said by several, that kind of slicing and dicing, if you will, is unhelpful, and I want to say characteristically Western, quite frankly, and not as useful as it might have been at another time for some of us. It's all of those things, but our essential unity is, of course, in Jesus Christ, into whom every one of us that calls the name, calls ourselves Christian, whether United Methodist or otherwise, we've been baptized into Jesus Christ. And it is our everlasting joy and privilege, and sometimes it's our stretch, to live up, as the apostle said to the Ephesians, to the full measure of the stature of Jesus Christ. And we're working at that in community. And even these struggles around which we gather with one another, the struggle that we're having about, you know, how do we live our life? A healthy sexual being and expression. It is the church as a whole yearning to live up to the full measure of the stature of Jesus Christ.
Great. We're going to turn to another question. David Wheeler asks, what needs to happen so that people on both sides of this debate can feel that General Conference 2016 paves the way for a brighter future for the United Methodist Church? Bishop, any of the bishops? Or Neil?
Since I was reading the book, the chapters of the other colleagues, Finding Our Way, I am resonating with the suggestions Bishop Ruben Job made to us. And this is one thing that needs to happen, that we really prepare ourselves in a prayer that is open, not parochial in a sense that I just pray that what I think has to happen will happen, but a prayer that opens up that we together, by God's grace and by the Holy Spirit, can live into a way that is created by more integrity, more grace, more missional engagement. So prayer is the first thing I want to highlight at this point.
Bishop Ward and then Bishop Talbert.
I just last week read Steve Harper's book, For the Sake of the Bride. And in a very remarkable way, he shares his Lenten journey in 2014, which begins with prayer. As Bishop Minner has just commented. And his journey takes him to the heart of our Wesleyan way, which is love. And I would hold with him love as the center of our life, love as the way in which we are unified with one another, and love as the content of our mission. Lifting the Wesleyan way of love and grace to the highest value needs to happen so that we can move forward.
Bishop Talbert?
In our church, the phrase, don't ask, don't tell, is a reality. All across our church now, same gender weddings are being held. Some bishops know about it and they don't do anything about it because it's done in secret. But when people choose to do the right thing in public, they become the brunt of the law. It's time for us as bishops to talk about the hypocrisy of what it means to live in covenant. We're not in covenant when we continue to embody don't ask, don't tell. It's time for us to speak truth. And that is not happening across our connection. The final word I want to say at this point is, prior to 1972, there was nothing in the Book of Discipline about this issue the way it's in there now. And our church was getting along pretty good. We have somehow felt that it's important for the General Conference to reach into what is the historic role of a pastor and say, this is something you must do or you cannot do while you have the freedom to do all of the other things that one is called to do and to use discretion in doing it. It's time for us to talk about that and to say to our church, we should no longer put those kind of restrictions on those who are ordained, but give them as pastors the freedom to do what they need to do. And then you can call on congregations then to be the loving congregations that they ought to be. But congregations out there now dealing with this issue, they are doing these harmful things because we have these restrictive laws and these derogatory statements enshrined in our book of law.
Thank you, Bishop Talbert. I'm going to go to Bishop Palmer and then Bishop Carter.
One of the responses to the question of what is it we need to do in 2016, we certainly don't need to wait until the General Conference, but I hope that the General Conference, as a part of its life together, recognizing those delegates are still in the process of being elected in the annual conferences, will begin now, the whole, throughout the whole church, all of us will be invited into this deepened God awareness and prayer of which Brother Alexander spoke in behalf of Bishop Reuben Job. And a part of that cycle of prayer, I trust, coming out of our own liturgical and worship tradition, will include starting with confession. We have not loved God with our whole heart, a phrase from a well-known prayer in the life of our church. We have failed to be an obedient church in so many ways, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. And so I believe that, for example, that last phrase and our living deeply into what does it mean to love all of our neighbors as ourselves, what are the implications of that in every respect might be an excellent place for us to begin, but not to begin and then leave it behind, but to sort of keep it as a part of the cycle of confession and repentance and experiencing the continuing loving grace of God from God and from God through one another.
Go ahead, Bishop Carter.
I think it's a great question, and I have appreciated the responses, and so I just want to give sort of two or three quick bullet point answers. It's a very hopeful question. I preface that by saying many of the questions on the Twitter feed seem to be from sort of one tribe or another. I call them tribes in our church, and people are sort of wondering, is this bishop in my tribe, or, you know, are they resonating with me? And, you know, I do want to say my understanding of being a bishop is that we really try to be bishops to all people who were within our care, and it's an honor to do that work. My three specific bullet point responses to the question would be, first, to treat people as people. I'm hearing clearly not to treat people as issues. No one wants to be understood as an issue. And I wonder if some of the impoverished theology of our church and practice is that baptism is not our fundamental identity. And I've had gay and lesbian friends say to me, you know, my baptism is my fundamental identity. So people are not issues, and before LGBTQ, and deeper than that, there is baptism. Second, if we're really gonna make progress, all of us, myself included, we're just gonna have to purge some of our assumptions, question some of our assumptions. Many of us have become hardened and rigid and not open to learning even. And it's not that, and I realize that this is the case, but if we don't do this, then General Conference is really just a sort of a will to power in which people do harm to each other. And then the last piece, which not everyone will agree with what I'm about to say, but from a philosophical point of view, the end does not justify the means. Whether your desired end is doctrinal purity or whether your desired end is being on the right side of history. We must do the work of Jesus in the way of Jesus if we are followers of Jesus.
Thank you, Bishop Carter. I'm going to turn to another question on our Twitter feed, and it comes from Jeremy Smith. It says, as church experts, are there models of unity that better include diversity in belief alongside unity in mission? And I'm going to turn to Neil Alexander to give a comment on this question. Neil.
Hi, Jeremy. Marvelous question. It seems to me that we all, as church experts living in faith communities that have found clarity, purposefulness, grace, and active learning through engagement in our communities and with the world, caring for those who hurt, seeking justice, advancing mercy, feeding the hungry, working with the poor to eradicate systems of oppression. Every time that happens, that's the example of unity in mission. And it occurs to me as we had some of these questions, we're looking as though we can settle this, as though we can find the right construct and articulation, and we can affirm it and adopt it and be done. And I think that's wrongheaded. I think it's not possible, and I don't think it's what we're called to do. So yes, I think there are many models of unity that include diversity in neighborhoods and in mission stations, in congregations, and in the communities they serve. And I think that's what we ought to use as our encouragement to give us courage to keep going.
Bishop Ward?
I think we saw one model of this in the first video. As a congregation was described, very much in love with the people in that congregation and loving across differences. I'm confident in no congregation is there agreement. Where numbers of people are gathered, there will always be varying viewpoints. But again, unity is not uniformity. And in this first video, we felt the mission which this congregation had in integrity out into the world. We could also look at judicatory possibilities, models. For example, the Methodist Church of Southern Africa is a case study in diversity of belief with unity of mission. Other denominations in the United States also have moved. The Episcopal Church, the Presbyterian Church, ELCA, have moved to models which give greater latitude for pastoral discretion and for local development of mission across differences. And I think we could list numbers of churches that are like this church we heard described in the first video. I could certainly list a number of which I am aware, and my brother and sister bishops could list others, where through most often sustained pastoral leadership, where there is a skilled, faithful pastor able to embrace, to convene, to encourage, that this is very much in our midst, both locally and beyond in other judicatories.
All right, I see Bishop Venner looking.
And Bishop Laurie was quoting the term that I have used in my little speech, unity and reconciled diversity. This is this comes out of an ecumenical approach amongst the Protestant churches all over Europe. And the process has been to define the core, and from that defining the core, giving freedom in many expressions. And the core is the right understanding of the gospel. And I think, and I see this today in many of the Protestant churches all over Europe, they are not one-minded on the question on human sexuality as we are not one-minded, but many of them have said this is not the core. This is not the core of our understanding of the gospel. This is the core is the justifying and reconciling work of Jesus Christ happening in our midst and our living together in loving relationships. So perhaps this could be a way forward for us, that we put into our center our theology of grace, and from then on learn to live with differences in a different way, and learning this from models. Bishop Ward has pointed out several of those models.
I think Bishop Talbert, do you want to get one more word, and then
yes,
we'll turn to the next tweet.
Last Sunday, I was privileged to preach in a congregation in North Carolina where they baptized four people, took in six people into membership. The people joined that church and were baptized because they finally found a place where the congregation was inviting and welcoming to all of their family members, and particularly an uncle who happened to be gay. They wanted to have their children baptized in a church where they felt that their uncle was welcomed. The second thing that happened after the service was over, a woman 76 years old, she said, "I joined this congregation because for a number of years I was going from place to place trying to find some community where I could feel at home. And when I came to this congregation, I found my home." I pray for all of our congregations to become those kind of places. But the impediment for too many of them are what we as a denomination have done to prohibit that kind of openness. And I want to see us as leaders say to our denomination, remove those barriers so that our congregations can be those loving places that Jesus would want them to be.
Thank you, Bishop Talbert. We're going to turn to Jessica Dason, and she asks the question, what are some better ways for United Methodists in the U.S. to be in ongoing dialogue with United Methodists around the world? I think we are very cognizant of the fact that our central conference voice, Bishop, is Bishop Venner, and that we do not have representation from our central conferences in both Africa and in Asia. And so, friends, what would you say to our colleagues around the world? How do we be in ongoing dialogue?
I want to pick up on one thing, a piece of one thing that Bishop Talbert mentioned earlier about life in the Council of Bishops. That actually is one place in which conversation across the globe can take place, because there are bishops from much of the world, and certainly North America, Europe, the Philippines, and Africa, who are regularly engaged and constitutive parts of the Council of Bishops. A second way is for us, wherever we happen to be, all of us here except for Bishop Venner are U.S. based, but there is increasing diversity in the geographies in which we live in the United States, and I know it's also true in Europe, because Bishop Venner has taken me to those kinds of settings in one of the German annual conferences. So to assume that we live one place and there is not worldwide diversity in those communities and in our congregations is simply not the way it is anymore. So we have opportunity for that kind of conversation among United Methodists whose place of birth, first language, etc., where people are already together across different lines.
Thank you. Bishop Venner?
I would like to say two different things. One is that I'm so sad that Bishop Yambasu cannot be with us today. And this again shows us that we are fighting on so many different places, and the struggle our sisters and brothers in West Africa are in, a struggle against the Ebola crisis, is so obvious. So let us not forget what it means to be connected in prayer in these moments and see all the many dimensions of a struggle for better future for God's people in this world. And the second thing is, there are so many occasions in this small world using all those technical possibilities. I know that many people in Germany are watching us in this moment and in other places of the world as well. And we can engage with one another through technical means. Please, if you are traveling, wherever you are going, meet with sisters and brothers in Christ, meet with churches and church people, ask how do you live, what's your missional context, what's your story, your experience in Christ. We have much more opportunities than we use. As Bishop Palmer was saying, the world is next door, so let's start right there.
Thank you. Others? Bishop Carter?
I think just to place a larger frame around our relationships with our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world, thinking about West Africa, I've had the honor of preaching at their annual conference and have traveled all over Liberia and met many of the persons who really are whose lives are being threatened by the spread of this virus. They're our brother and sister United Methodist Christians. Thinking about the persecuted church in the Middle East in places like Iraq, where in Mosul Christianity has been virtually eliminated, a 1,600-year-old church, Iran, Syria, Palestine. As we engage in relationships with our brothers and sisters around the world, we find that our concerns and our passions are expanded. Certainly, the focus of this conversation remains crucial and important, but my experience has been that when I really listen to a United Methodist Christian from another part of the world, this is often the experience of General Conference, they will say to me, I have an additional concern. And so it is really being in a spirit of speaking, but also listening.
I want to turn to this other question because I think it's relevant to a worldwide nature that's influenced by culture as well. And the question comes from Carolyn France. In some ways, this is a disagreement over hermeneutics. Is there room for more than one biblical interpretation? And as Bishop Carter had recognized, you know, many of our questions are coming from one tribe of our church. And the question is, are other tribes concerned about how we look at interpreting the Bible? Bishop Ward?
Yes, I'd like to respond because I do believe very much that there is space for us all to engage the scripture with those around us and to be lifelong learners and for us to speak the truth that all across the spectrum of view on this, there is scriptural grounding. This is not a justice sort of movement over against a scriptural movement, not at all. We are all people who love scripture and who are attentive to scripture. Christine Pohl at Asbury Seminary reminds us that one quality of a healthy congregation or organization is the ability to tell the truth. And it is a simple, observable truth that we differ on how we interpret scripture around these matters of human sexuality. So I would say with an emphatic yes, absolutely, there is room for more than one view or opinion on what scripture is saying about this.
Thank you. Bishop Talbert?
I want to keep us on the issue that's before us, and that's the issue of human sexuality. More specifically, people who are not heterosexuals. People of all genders are in our churches. They're not out there. And the question is, how do we live with our sisters and brothers who are of a different orientation but find themselves fully engaged in our churches across the connection? For those who are heterosexual, we find ourselves free when it comes to this discussion of human sexuality. But people of other orientations find themselves imprisoned because they can't be who they are. My sisters and brothers, it's time for us to pull the cover off and start talking about who we are in our human sexuality so that we can accept one another as brothers in Christ. I just pray that we come to the day when we can do that. Thank you.
Anyone else have some words to add to this? Bishop Carter.
I appreciate this question around scripture, and I just would encourage the folks who are engaging in this conversation just simply to immerse yourselves in the stories of Jesus, the parables of Jesus. They are always surprising. They're always grace-filled. They're always teaching us that Jesus is constantly crossing boundaries to be in relationships with people that we might not have imagined. There is more space within the scriptures for gracious, just relationships with our brothers and sisters than we often are able to stand in.
Thank you, Bishop Carter. I want to take a moment to turn to our umc.org website, in which this conversation continues to reside. On the website, there is a section called Sharing in Faith, a forum on sexuality and the church. And acknowledging that we have, we've been hearing largely from one voice of the church, there's a place in there that comes from Reverend Kenneth Livingston of Houston. And it does speak a little bit to our scriptural references. And it says, I had to trust God's word. Reverend Livingston gives his testimony about his experience as a pastor and his own challenges with both sexuality and culture. He writes, I grew up in a community where participating in promiscuous activities was a badge of honor to be celebrated among my peers. He then articulates a conviction upon his heart to be transformed from that culture into a faithful following into the scriptures. The following called him to a traditional reading of the scriptures on human sexuality and homosexuality in particular. This comes directly from his post. In cases where single heterosexual adults were engaged in sexual relationships outside of marriage, I invited them to consider whether their walk was in harmony with the word and will of God. Many continued the same conduct, but not a single one ever said, I believe God is pleased with my conduct. When people who struggle with same-sex attractions and conduct came to me, I invited them to consider questions about what is pleasing to God. I can't imagine the torment and the pain that they went through as they honestly tried to answer the questions. I seek to be the best pastor I can be without compromising the clear word that God's design for living out our sexuality is within the bond of marriage between a man and a woman. At the heart of our struggle is whether the Bible is authoritative for our lives. Are we people of the book when it says what we want to hear? I think that's one of the other sides of the conversation, and the conviction that if we don't pay attention to some of the ways in which others interpret, we are challenged to the authority of the Bible. Can any of you speak to that, to Reverend Livingston's question?
Yeah,
Bishop Ward?
Well, again, I'm indebted to Steve Harper's observation around this in For the Sake of the Bride. But he lifts the importance of the quality of the relationship more than the gendering of the relationship.
Right.
Because we have been unwilling to compare heterosexual marriage at its worst, including divorce and serial monogamy, et cetera, on the heterosexual side, while we have been able to speak of those on the homosexual orientation in derogatory ways without looking at the possibility of committed long-term relationships, such as, again, we saw demonstrated in the first video. And I find his observation very compelling, that we begin to look more out of Scripture at the quality of relationship and the covenant of relationship over time, and to back off a bit from what seems to me to be a less resonant theme in Scripture around homosexuality. Only 7 places in the Scripture directly address homosexual practice.
Thank you, Bishop Ward. Bishop Carter?
I just affirm what Bishop Ward has said. I think scriptural interpretation is really a calling for pastors and teachers and Sunday school classes. There's a lot at stake, as we realized earlier in watching the videos. And I believe the longer I live, the more I read Scripture, it's a deep well, and there's a real complexity to it. I've been working on Acts 15 for a gathering we're having in the Florida conference, and clearly there for me is an analogy between the Gentiles in Acts 15 and persons who are marginalized in our own time. There's a sense that the boundaries have been broken down around identity. There's also some complexity in the passage about behavior and boundaries. Clearly that's a turning point for the early church. We're in a similar turning point now. I believe a question about Scripture is valid, but it's more complex than we often imagine.
Thank you very much. I'm gonna give Bishop Lowry 1 minute to respond, and then we're gonna go ahead and wrap up.
Thank you. I want to say a word of appreciation for the integrity of the witness that Reverend Livingston has offered in his remarks. We need to be careful, I think. Both Bishop Ward and Carter have been right to call us to a carefulness in the way we interpret Scripture. Part of our wrestling is we tend to want to interpret Scripture in ways where it says what we have already arrived at as our own position, rather than let Scripture read us. And so I would call us to not shy away from the ways in which Scripture calls us to God's preferences rather than our desires, as a part of the integrity of the conversation and issue. I would also want to do that in a way that gracefully says, look, there is a complexity here that we need to embrace and understand, but we need not to be shy about its witness or its teaching.
Thank you very much, Bishop Lowry. Mm-hmm. You know, today's panel was neither the beginning nor the end of this conversation, and we hope that it is, again, another entry point for us to continue this conversation. We need for these kinds of conversations to happen across our connection, in our local churches, in our annual conferences, in our districts, everywhere around the world. These conversations will be here online for later viewing. And our next conversation will be in Mozambique in February of 2015. We hope that we will be able to hear directly from our Central Conference voices and learn about what it is that their perspectives that add to the rich diversity of our United Methodist Church. The CT Task Force has offered a few questions online, so please check the website, join us in this conversation. I'm gonna end with a word of prayer for my colleagues and friends. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we give thanks for your wisdom. Your wisdom that has come through us through this opportunity to conference together for the sake of your mission in this world today. We know that it is your grace and love which shines brightly throughout each and every person you have called, Lord, to this place, to this table, and through the questions that we've heard this day. May your witness, may your grace, and may your love ever abound in us and through us for the sake of your gospel mission in this world. May all come to know of the saving love of our Savior, Jesus Christ. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.